I'm excited. You look at the stage. We've been preaching through a series this month called I've Got Work to Do. And the behavioral objective is not talking about the work of doing necessarily church work, but the work of working on ourselves. And this morning at 8 o'clock, we preach from the subject that I'm starting with me. And so let's go back to the Gospel of John, chapter 4, verse 4. The Gospel of John, chapter 4, verse 4. We're going to read one verse. Please pray with me as I try to lay some framework for where we're going today. Real simple scripture. It simply says, he had to go through Samaria on the way. King James Version reads this way. It says, I must needs go through Samaria. It's really Jesus talking, and he says, look, I got to go through Samaria on the way. And so the reality is at the 10 o'clock worship experience, 8 o'clock this morning, I preached from the subject, I'm starting with me. My assignment at 10 o'clock is to preach from the subject, I'm not there yet. I'm not there yet. Would you just put in the chat, be honest with yourself and just go ahead and put in the chat right now, or turn to somebody and just tell them, I'm going to come clean with you. I'm not there yet. I'm not there yet. Father, I pray for anointing that will enable me to make the word speak clearly. I claim receiving the ability to share. My heart is ready. My mind is receptive. Would you use lips of clay? Use the flesh that I am to be the oracle of God. May it be none of me and all of you that everyone hears. God, it is my prayer that you preach to me through me. May the word that I preach and the meditation of my heart be acceptable. I claim that authority now in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. I'm going to come clean with you. You heard me talking about right then how at Norfolk State I started with 050 math and things like that. The reality is it doesn't matter. I got a degree just like everybody else. It was funny because yesterday they had the graduates stand up that were magna cum laude, summa cum laude, cum laude. And then I leaned over to the rector and said, they ought to call the other category. I graduated with honors as well. She said, what was that? I said, thank you, laude. I graduated. Thank you, laude. And so you've heard me declare I was probably a slower learner in the academic process. Well, watch this. I was a slower learner also in the theological process. I might be one of the first people that struggled in vacation Bible school because there were just certain things that were taught that I was just challenged with. Can I come clean with you today? I know I'm not the only one. I saw you just sit up on the edge of the bed because you got some challenges with what have been taught to you. I'll give you an example. One scripture, maybe two scriptures, really used to always rock me. And here's one, Isaiah 53:3. It would really always rock me. It says, he was despised and rejected, a man of sorrows, comma. Okay, watch this. Acquainted with deepest grief. Now, you know, the reality is, I'm like, okay, so y'all gonna tell me that Jesus was acquainted, you know, what they used to always say is he was acquainted with your grief. I'm like, I don't see nowhere in Jesus' story where every year when the teacher would call the roll and she would say Kimberly Brown and you would say here, and the teacher would say, oh boy, stop playing now, it's the first day of school, and send you to the principal's office. I don't see anywhere in the scripture where I could confirm that Jesus was acquainted with my grief. So that would really mess with me. Isaiah 53:3, we turned our backs on him and looked the other way. He was despised and we did not care. I just didn't see that. And then the other one was Hebrews 4:15. Hebrews 4:15 used to always rock me. This high priest of ours understands our weaknesses. Okay, so he understands our weaknesses. Watch this now. This is where it would trip me out. Calvin, I want you to hear this. For he faced all the same testings we do, yet he did not sin. I just really used to have a hard way of processing. Okay, so you're going to tell me that there was no temptation or no test that confronted me that Jesus didn't have to deal with as well. I just didn't understand that. And the reason why I didn't understand it is because, Alex, I was only seeing Jesus through the lens of his divinity. Talk to me, somebody. See, if you only see Jesus as the Jesus that is your Savior, that's on your mama's mantel place in the gold frame with the light hanging off the top, if you only see Jesus as the man that could turn blind eyes into being able to see, or turn water into wine, or could heal lepers, you will miss a true and realistic picture of who Jesus is. I got to move. Watch this. Once I started to realize that Jesus was fully God and fully man, then I recognized as God, he might not be acquainted with my grief. But as a man, as a human, the same temptations that I deal with every day, Jesus dealt with. The only difference is the text says that Jesus didn't sin. That's why the Bible makes it clear we have a high priest who's acquainted with our grief. And I want to suggest to you, I know I stretched you at 8 o'clock. I'm going to stretch you again at 10. That when we get to the Gospel of John, chapter 4, I want to suggest to you that in verse 4, it is the human side of Jesus that is wrestling with some issues. And Jesus, here it is, Jesus comes to the recognition that he's not there yet. Oh, God. Now, I know. Now, see, watch, stay with me. Don't turn off because I'm messing with your theology. The God half of Jesus, he's fully God. That side of him is perfect. But the human side of Jesus is flesh. He is a God man. See, watch this. The stuff that we used to hear, or we used to get celebrated when the preacher would pray, he was born of a woman. Okay, well, if he's born of a woman, that's flesh. So, or he came down through 42 generations. Watch this. And he told God, I'll go create a body for me. Well, he came down when they pierced him in the side. Stuff that we sing. The blood came streaming that way. If the blood came streaming down, he was a man. And it is the man side of him, that masculinity, that when he gets ready to walk through John chapter 4, he says, you know what? I'm not there yet. I still got some issues that I need to work on in my human side, and I'm willing to confront them today. Can I suggest that becomes the experience that we step in today? Because I don't care how smart you are, I don't care how great you are at whatever you do, how anointed you are, how much money you have, how much intellect you have, wherever you've come from, if you're honest with yourself, if we look in the mirror, I want to suggest that all of us have to recognize I'm not there yet. There's some things that God still needs to deal with. There's some situations that God still needs to deliver me from. There are some things that I'm not proud of that I still fall victim to. Well, I wish you could shout that in the chat. Put it in all caps. I'm not there yet. And I want to suggest that Jesus becomes a tangible example for us to look at today, how we handle life when we acknowledge that I'm not there yet. Because I believe when we get to John chapter 4, Jesus sees himself on the way to Calvary. He knows that in a few days, he's going to be crucified and have to die and sacrifice for everybody, but he realizes that he's got some baggage on his human side that he needs to deal with. And so what I've learned is that's why you better be careful how you judge anybody else, lest you be judged, because the reality is none of us are there yet. If you think you are there now, if you think you've already arrived, why don't you just ask God, like it's a good Star Wars movie, to beam you up. But for those of you like me that will acknowledge today that I'm not there yet, there are some places, some imperfections, some stresses, some strains, and some struggles that I still wrestle with, that I need God to deal with. Why don't you get ready to take some notes, get ready to get your praise on, because I want to tell you how you handle it when you will be honest enough to declare I'm not there yet. Well, the first thing I think we've got to learn how to do, according to the scripture and watching the example of Jesus, you ready? We've got to learn how to release definitions. You know what's so amazing to me is how many people have definitions about other folk. Y'all know, come on, tell the truth, shame the devil. Talk to your boy right here, put that in the chat. You know you might not use those definitions publicly, but you know you got nomenclature and definitions that you use to define certain people, especially people that you have obvious biases with. I love the fact, listen to it, it's right here in verse 9 in chapter 4. It says, the woman was surprised, for Jews refused to have anything to do with Samaria. She said to Jesus, you are a Jew and I am a Samaritan woman. Why are you asking me for something? something to drink. Isn't it amazing how we got all these little definitions? And so we come up with all these conclusions. This person, they too holy. They holiness. And I'm Baptist and all this. You know what? I've learned that until we learn how to just release the definitions, because the last time I checked, I don't care whether you Baptist or Pentecostal, if I cut you, you're going to believe. The last time I checked, I don't care whether you black or brown, if I cut you, you're going to believe. The last time I checked, I don't care whether you got a lot of education or no education, if I cut you, you're going to believe. I'm preaching better than y'all shooting hearts and putting claps on it right now. I don't care if you're from the hood or from the biggest house in the city. When I cut you, you're going to believe. What I've learned is that words hurt you just like they hurt me. They hurt you whether you're broke or they hurt you whether you got money in your pocket. What I've learned is that we're all human beings, and the sooner we get over all these definitions, it's amazing to me how many definitions we have. I'm not going to throw them out because some of y'all would email me and be offended because I would use the definitions that you used just this morning, but you don't want me to use them, but it's acceptable for you to use them. Until you get over all the definitions that you use to refer to people's sexual orientation, or the definitions that you use to refer to people's ethnicity, or the definitions that you use to refer to people that are promiscuous or people that are not. The reality is, once we get over all the definitions, watch this. I'm going to help us right here. Can I go all in? I'm about to help somebody. If you really want to know the definition, there is only one definition that is universal. It is not the definitions that we typically use. There is only one definition that is universal. There is one definition that I give you permission to refer to yourself by. I give you permission to refer to me by. I give you permission to refer to people that you like by. I give you permission to refer to people that you don't like by. You want to know what it is? Sinner. All of us are sinners. All of us are sinners saved by grace. That's the only definition that is unilaterally true across the board. Robert, I don't care whether you got money in your pocket or not. All of us have sinned and come short of the glory of God. I don't care whether you're tall. I don't care whether you're size 3 or size 13. All of us are sinners. I don't care whether you got real hair, fake hair, paid for hair, or growing hair. All of us are sinners. I don't care whether you live in a big house, a small house, in the project, or in a mansion. All of us are sinners. And once we come to the conclusion of what 1 John chapter 4 verse 8 says, but anyone who does not love does not know God. Oh, there it is. But anyone who does not love. So let me tell you something. If that scripture is true, and I believe it's true because it's in the Bible, if you don't love somebody because of their sexual orientation, then you don't know God. If you don't love somebody because they don't believe what you believe politically, you don't love God. Because the Bible says, according to 1 John chapter 4 verse 8, anyone who does not love does not know God, for God is love. What I've learned is that the closer I get to God, the more I release my definitions. At this point in my life, I don't have any definitions. You know what I call people? People. You know what I call people? People. You know what I call people? People now. I've learned that the only definitions we need to be using are the ones that God has used. He called all of us a royal priesthood. He calls us a chosen generation. He calls us all his children. And I hate to bust your bubble. This is going to really rock somebody's world. He died for people that you don't like. He died for people who don't believe what you believe. He died for people who don't live their lifestyle the way you think lifestyle should be lived. So I hate to bust your bubble, but he died for those who are in same-sex marriages. He loved those that are monogamous. He loved those that are not monogamous. He knows those that are sinning. He loves everybody. And so the reality is, when Jesus gets ready to walk out his destiny, he declares in John chapter 4 verse 4, I need to go through Samaria. Why? Because I want to suggest that Jesus knew he needed to release some definitions. Okay, let's move further. Not only do we need to learn how to release definitions, but number two, we got to learn how to realize dependence. Okay, I knew that was going to be a little interesting right there. Realizing dependence. Can I suggest to you that I don't care who you are, you cannot become all that God has ordained for you to become by yourself. You hear me say this all the time. People be testifying, I pull myself up by my own bootstraps. Well, here's what I do. I challenge you, go in the bedroom right now, go in the closet, get some boots out, unlace them, and try to pull yourself up by your own bootstraps. Sit down on the floor in the kitchen. Put the bootstrap under your foot and try to pull yourself up by your own bootstraps. Do you not know it is physiologically not capable, not possible for you to pull yourself up by your own bootstrap? In fact, we were joking today on the way to church because I had the sad news that one of the VPs of Norfolk State, Dr. Satterfield, had died. And I got sad. Now, I want you to understand, I graduated from Norfolk State in 1984. And the reality is, I can't tell you how many times I went in Dr. Satterfield's office and all I had was $50. And I told Dr. Satterfield, my mama said if he would let me get in school, she would pay off my tuition by the end of the semester. And he would let me get in by with $50. Now, it didn't matter how good my GPA was. It didn't matter what class I was in. It didn't matter what my major was. I needed Dr. Satterfield in order to be able to get in Norfolk State. I don't know who needs to hear this today, but if you think you so bad that you're going to be able to become everything that God ordained you to be by yourself, you are missing something. In fact, somebody ought to jump up at home right now, because you know somebody was praying for you when you were in the club and they started shooting. You won't even have the ability to pray for yourself. I know many of us right now, we are where we are because mama prayed. We are where we are because granddaddy prayed, grandmama prayed, sisters prayed, brothers prayed. I want to acknowledge that I know if it had not been for people who loved me in spite of myself, I would never be where I am right now. What's so amazing to me is John chapter 4, watch this, verse 7 says, soon a Samaritan woman came to draw water, and Jesus said to her, please give me a drink. Come here, class, let me show you something. Now, if the woman came to draw water, that means that Minister Robert, we know two things about her. Number one, she had a bucket and a rope. She was able to draw water. Pastor Marcus, check this out. We also know as we read through the story that the water, that the well had a deep well, and the water was way down in the well. Because there's a part of the story where she tells Jesus, how are you going to draw water with no bucket and no rope? Because the water is deep. Okay, y'all going to make me work. I ain't scared of y'all. Watch this. I've learned that every now and then, more times than I want to acknowledge, God will send somebody into my life that I might not feel like I flow well with, but they have a bucket and a water, and they have the ability to draw what I need in life. Okay, you missed this. Stop, rewind, and play. What I've learned is that every now and then, you've got to come clean and say, you know what, God? I'm dependent on what somebody else has, and therefore, I'm going to have to humble myself. Let me say it another way. Now, I know you're saying, if you Pentecostal, you don't believe the Baptist folk are saved. Baptist folk believe Pentecostal folks are too loud. The Methodist folk believe this. We got all these little denominational moments, but let me tell you something. When you are thirsty and you are at the well and you don't have a bucket and a rope, you don't care whether the person that lets you use their bucket and rope speaks in tongues or not. Oh God, you just missed a turn. It's amazing to me how we have all these definitions and all these little disagreements, and the reality is, once I realize that I'm dependent, I have learned I can have relationship with anybody, especially if you've got my bucket and a rope and you're willing to allow me to use your bucket and your rope to be able to draw some water. That doesn't make sense to me, to be in need and you be so arrogant that you can't humble yourself enough to have relationship with somebody else that has what you need. That's why I love 1 Corinthians chapter 12 verse 7. Listen to what it says. A spiritual gift is given to each of us so we can help each other. I don't care how bad you are. You can't do it by yourself. I really think I'm a halfway decent preacher, but the reality is I don't know how to turn on the sound. I don't know how to connect to the internet. So the reality is, as good as I am at preaching, if I didn't have somebody sitting in a cold control room that could get the sound right and push this signal out, I need them. I need you to put in the tweet real quick or put in the chat. I need somebody. Now, what is the bucket and the rope? The bucket and the rope is a metaphor for that which you need in order to become as productive as possible in your life. Somebody ought to give God praise right there. What I've learned is that God has such a sense of humor. He will always give the bucket and the rope to somebody who doesn't look like me, somebody who doesn't think like me, somebody who might not have come through the journey I've come through, somebody that I've got to humble myself and put my stuff aside and be able to say, I need your help. Jesus sits down at the water. Okay, now I know somebody, I hear you. Somebody saying, well, you know, Jesus is God. If he could turn water into wine, he could have spoke to the well. If he can make the water stand up on the side for the Israelites to walk through on dry land, he could have dealt with the water in the well. Yes, that's true. But remember, the whole behavioral objective is that this is not the divine side of God. This is the flesh side of God. This is Jesus the man, not Jesus the Savior. And Jesus the man gets thirsty. You got to connect John chapter 4 with Calvary, because on Calvary's cross, he gets thirsty again. And it is a Roman soldier. God, I'm preaching better than y'all shooting hearts. It is a Roman soldier who takes a sponge and holds it up to him. I've come to declare over you and I, you better get to the point that you can recognize your dependence and realize you're going to need somebody. I'm going to say it until you catch it. You're going to need somebody. I'm going to say it until you catch it. You're going to need somebody. That's why I've got to understand what the Bible declares. I've got to learn how to release my definitions. I've got to learn how to realize dependence. But then thirdly, I've got to learn how to respect differences. It's amazing how much stuff we argue about that in the scheme of life really doesn't matter. It's amazing to me, because yesterday was so important to me, because I'm old school. You feeling me? I'm old school. So when you come to graduation, oh God, I'm getting ready to show y'all something. When you come to graduation, I remember graduation. I remember graduation where if you didn't have on some stockings and some black shoes with closed toes, they'd make you get out of the graduation line. That's the graduation that I'm remembering. But the reality is, that's not the graduation I saw yesterday. I saw all kinds of shoes. I saw all kinds of dresses. And before I sat up there and got judgmental, I sat there and see, you had some guys that were coming across the stage and they were doing their thing. I just thought you're supposed to walk across the stage, shake hands with the president, and just act dignified. And then God checked me and he said, let me show you something. Before you judge anybody up here, you got to understand, you don't know their journey. You don't know what they had to come through to be able to walk on this stage. And then I started to think about the fact that if you don't know my story, don't judge my destiny. I need somebody that'll help me preach this thing right here. I love the fact, listen to the story in John chapter 4. Sister Shannon is crazy. In verse 20, he says, tell me, why is it that the Jews insist that Jerusalem is the only place of worship, while we Samaritans claim that it's here at Mount Gerizim? Why are your ancestors worshiping on the wrong mountain? You know what? That's exactly what's going on in the body of Christ right now. So if your church is Pentecostal, you can't worship with Baptist folk. And if you Baptist, you don't want to worship with the Episcopalian. And if you Episcopalian, you don't want to worship with the Presbyterian. Well, what in the world are we going to do when we get to heaven? Because I hate to bust your bubble. Ain't going to be no Baptist heaven. Ain't going to be no Pentecostal heaven. Ain't going to be no Methodist heaven. Ain't going to be no Presbyterian heaven. The Bible says when all God's children get together. So you know what I've learned now? I can worship with anybody that loves Jesus. We might not agree on whether or not you need to wear a hat or not, but do you love Jesus? We might not agree on whether or not men and women can preach, but do you love Jesus? We might not agree on whether you should sing only hymns or can you sing CCM, but do you love Jesus? We might not agree on should you bring tithe or give whatever you want to give. All I need to know is, do you love Jesus? Can I go a little old school for you today? Because I feel something rising up. All I need to know is one thing. Is he the lily in your valley? Is he your bright and morning star? Is he a brother that's sticking closer than anybody? Did he die for your sin? We can get over everything else as long as you say he's Mary's baby that's soon to come back. I don't care whether you want to wear robes in the choir or wear jeans in the choir. Do you know who Jesus is? Because that's the only thing that matters. When it's all said and done, only what you do for Christ is going to really matter. So when Jesus gets there, I love the fact that Matthew 7 verse 1-2 tells us, do not judge others and you will not be judged. Can I let y'all in on a secret? I ain't got time to judge anybody. Why? I don't want God to judge me, because God knows there's some things about me that nobody else knows. And I don't want to judge you, because I don't want God judging me. I want God to look beyond my faults and still see my need, so I'm able to look beyond your fault and still see your need. I want God to give me amazing grace, so I'm willing to give you amazing grace. I want God to take care of my needs, so I'm willing to help take care of your needs, because I'm not there yet. and I'm not there yet. So number one, I got to learn how to release definitions. Oh God, I feel like lifting you up. I got to learn how to release dependence. I got to learn how to respect our differences. But Troy, this is what hit me. I've got to learn how to remember my deployment. Aisha, I'm on my way somewhere. I don't know who needs to hear this. Minister Earl, I'm on my way somewhere. I don't have time to worry about all these little incidental moments here. Because Jesus was on his way to Galilee, y'all. He says, I've got to go through Samaria on my way. I don't know who I'm preaching to right now. But I wish we had a church full of folk. Because I tell you to turn to somebody and tell them, I didn't come here to stay. I'm not going to get stuck in this place. I'm on my way somewhere. I might not know where God is taking me. But I know where I am is not it yet. I might not know how there ultimately looks. But I know there's more that God wants to do with me than what he's doing right now. I'm on my way somewhere. I've got deployment. God is sending me somewhere. God is calling me somewhere. And so the Bible says in John chapter 4, verse 3, so he left Judea and started to return to Galilee. Who am I preaching to around the world? I've come to declare over you and prophesy over you. You on your way somewhere. You ain't got time to be mad at folk. You ain't got time to be holding a grudge. You ain't got time to be majoring on other people's imperfections. You on your way somewhere. Get yourself together and realize God is calling me. God is sending me. God has anointed me. That's why Philippians chapter 3 verse 13 says, so dear brothers and sisters, I have not achieved it yet, but I focus on the one thing, forgetting those things in the past, and I'm pressing towards, looking at what's in front of me. I want you to know, too much is in front of you for you to still be mad at your sister. Too much is in front of you for you to still be holding a grudge over a crazy coworker. Too much is in front of you. God has been too good. He's brought you too far. He's opened up too many doors. How dare you still be mad at somebody with all that God is doing in your life? I've got work to do. And I'm acknowledging today that I'm not there yet. That's why Philippians chapter 3 verse 14 says, I press on to reach the end of the race and receive the heavenly prize for which God through Christ Jesus is calling me. As I get ready to do the invitation, the other day God showed me this example. And I was watching him, Earl, run a marathon. And what was amazing is, in the marathon, after they ran so many miles, there were people that were waiting on the side with cups of water. The people didn't stop running. They simply held their hand out and people passed them water. Watch this, y'all. Hear your boy well. They didn't have time to stop and worry about whether the person giving them the cup of water believed what they believed. They didn't have time to stop and ask them about what they believed about marriage and what they believed about politics. They were so glad that somebody was holding out a cup of water that they kept running. I'm telling you, in this season that we're living through right now, you got to recognize we're running a marathon. And it does not make sense to be running for your life and somebody offer you something that's required for your destiny. And you say, I can't drink that because you Baptist. Or I can't drink that because you black. Or I can't drink that because you white. Let me tell you something. I'm on my way somewhere. And so I'm making a declaration today. I don't care whether you believe what I believe politically or not. If you got my bucket and my rope, we ain't got to talk about politics. Because we'll never agree. But I need a bucket and a rope. And so I'm willing to acknowledge that I'm not there yet. But what I'm going to start doing is releasing definitions, realizing my dependence, respecting our differences, and then I'm going to remember my deployment. Jesus would have never made it to Calvary with all of his destiny in place if he had not dealt with this woman at the well in Samaria. I challenge you today, find what your Samaria is. And remember, you don't go to Samaria to stay. You go there on your way. Three invitations for you today. Invitation number one is to accept the Lord as your Savior. Woo, God, I feel your anointing right there. Invitation number two is to rededicate your life to Christ. Invitation number three is to become a part of this great fellowship called the Mount Chesapeake, or the Mount Virtual, Mount Global, Mount Cyber, whatever term you need to use. So if you desire to accept Jesus as your Savior, just text the word accept to 71441. If you desire to rededicate your life to Christ, all you got to do is text the word restart. God, I feel like lifting you up to 71441. Or if you desire to tangibly connect to us, you believe I am a voice of the Spirit in your life, all you got to do is text mount up to 71441. As soon as you do that, you'll be prompted. Follow the direction of the prompt. Don't rob us of the great honor to be able to help you walk out your future. Look, let me remind you one more time. We've got work to do. And today we decided, guess what? We're not there yet. So I challenge you, you work on you. I make a promise to you, I'm going to work on me. And one day we're going to become all that God has ordained us to be. Now unto him who is able to keep us from falling, present us faultless before the throne of God, to the only almighty God, be glory and majesty, dominion and power. I call you blessed in the city, blessed in the field, blessed when you come and blessed when you go, in Jesus' name.